Right, here we are. Wednesday night, February 25th, 2015. It happens to be Shab'aba Adar, the 7th of Adar. And 7th of Adar is something that seems to have been forgotten in the community. Growing up, it existed. You finish praying Minhar Arbit. It's basically still winter time. It gets dark right away, so it's nighttime. By the time you finish praying Arbit, and all of a sudden, everybody gathers around, sits at the tables to start reading the Tikkun of Shab'aba Adar. We have Tikkun of Hosha'a Rabbah that we all know, we stay up all night. Tikkun of Shavuot, we stay up all night. They have Tikkun of Shabi'i Shal Pesach, when you get up early morning, pre-dawn, to read. Shab'aba Adar has been forgotten. In fact, the most modern Kiri'i Mu'ed and Tikkun books don't even have it printed in it anymore. Why? I don't know. Tikkun Shab'aba Adar is done in memory of Moshe Rabbeinu, alayhi shalom. According to tradition, he was born on Shab'aba Adar, he died on Shab'aba Adar. In any case, I just wanted to mention it because it was something that was done in this community here in Brooklyn, as well as, you know, obviously going back to Syria, Egypt, Iraq, Lebanon, all over. They all did it. The readings basically focused upon Moshe Rabbeinu. Talked about the death of Moshe, the beginning of Sefer Yehoshua. He read a short portion over there. He read some Mizmorim of Tehillim, like Tefillah Moshe. And he read Pirkei Avot, the beginning, which is the first perek, which starts with Moshe Kibbel Torah Misinai. He jumped to the fifth perek, which talks about all different happenings that happened. There's different sayings of God, different generations from Adam until Noah, etc. The generations from Noah to Abraham, the 10 different tests. It goes through different phases of history, basically that fifth perek of Pirkei Avot. And then there's some people read some Gemara from Masechet Sota, some Yalkut of Parashat Ve'et Hanan. It's a short reading, a little bit of Zohar, and after an hour and a half, 2 hours, you're done, you go home, you have dinner. It was done, it was a simple thing, but today, it's not even done anymore. It's not announced anymore, it's forgotten. Why? I don't know. So I wanted to make sure this is recorded and you're aware of it. So if you want to do it, you know, we could always do it. And if you don't want to do it, at least you know it exists. And you can tell your children about it. Okay. This Shabbat, Shabbat Zachor. Right? We've discussed Shabbat Zachor ad nauseum. Is it obligatory, not obligatory? We're not going to discuss that. I want to go back to one of the earliest writings that I have from Rabbi Chaim David HaLevi, his first volume of Aseh Lecha Rab, where he touches upon questions that have to do with somewhat philosophical issues. And that's where he first came out with this very short, simple, concise style of his in his popular Teshuvot, for the average Joe. So I wanted to look at that and see how we actually put remembering Amalek into perspective for us today, basically, you know, based upon how he's looking at it, and see how we can actually remember Amalek and destroying Amalek. So we'll look at Aseh Lecha Rab, Volume 1, Siman He, page 22. Zachor et Amalek. Kifshuta. In the most simple form. Nu'ada mizvat zikhirat Amalek kedil qiyim mizva ahiret. We were given this mizvah of remembering Amalek. Why? In order to fulfill a different mizvah, being vehi limhod et zikr Amalek, to eradicate the memory of Amalek. سامر هالشيحي توت شل هروديف أحري نيح الشاليم عيفيم بغعيم ومزنبهم لدور حميم كاشل إن بيادام لهد جونين. You have to remember, you had weary travelers, travelers that had no knowledge of warfare, travelers that were traveling with women, with children, with elderly, with sick, just trudging along in the desert. You had stragglers at the end of all these travelers, and all of a sudden, this mighty warrior nation of Amalek comes and attacks. Zero mercy. Ach ein zeh kol, but that's not all. Rabot yishlmod mizichron Amalek. We have a lot to learn from the remembrance of Amalek. V'ula she'akol b'chlem mizvat zechir Amalek. And possibly it's all included in this mizvah of remembering Amalek. Ze'ata yasah am Mitzrayim. That very moment, nation of Am Yisrael leaving Egypt, lo b'kocho, v'lo b'tbunato, they didn't decide to pick up and leave. They were chased out. They had to leave. God wanted them out. Par'o wanted them out. They didn't make preparations for this. Aisra makot el suot misrim ligarish Yisrael ma'osam. After the 10 plagues, the Egyptians didn't want to know from the Jews anymore. They banished them. וישראל עצמם נסתוו לא לעשות מאומה, להיות פסיביים. בני ישראל was commanded not to do anything at all, just be passive. ואתם לא תשאו איש מפתח ביתו עד בוקר. They were given a command in the Torah. Don't do anything, don't even walk out your doors till the morning. פרעו רודף אחרי ישראל. All of a sudden, Paro comes chasing after them. And all of a sudden, he had this tremendous, tremendous miracle of the splitting of the sea. And the enemies of Am Yisrael, namely the Egyptians, drowning in the waters. Once again, the Jews did nothing. The Jews didn't fight back and cause the Egyptians to drown. They did nothing. Just walked along passively. I'm going on my way. I'm not bothering anybody. Nobody's bothering me. I have nothing to do with anybody. All of a sudden, lo and behold, Amalek shows up. All of a sudden, trembling comes upon the Israelite camp. If you look at Rashi over there in Shemot, Perek Yud Zayin, Pasuk Yod, says that caused them to fast. V'tefila merukezet v'gedola shel Moshe b'nisiat yadav kalpei ma'ala. And Moshe Rabbeinu has his hands outstretched to the heavens praying. U'milhama r'sinit shel Yehoshua im b'bhar b'nei Yisrael gibbonim v'yirehet. And Yehoshua is out there having a serious fight. Okay, he chose. How many people could he have chosen from Israel? You know, the Gibborim v'Yirehet. How many people fell into, such a
minority,
such a category of being heroes and fearful of sin? V'lechora ma pachad shetakaf Israel v'chi b'kocham him echniu et amislim v'yazu me'arsam al ki takafam pachad m'pnei Amalek pen lo yuchlu lahim. V'rei Elohim, shenalham lahem b'mislaim, yechol lahem lahem gam Amalek. But the Jews were afraid. But why were they afraid? They didn't lift a finger to fight the Egyptians the entire time. Plagues came upon them, and they sat back and relaxed. Plagues didn't affect them. Paro comes chasing them. They crossed. The sea split for them, and they crossed like nothing. Hashem closed the water upon the Egyptians, drowned them. So why are they afraid now? Can't God take care of the Amalek too? What's the problem? Vav gamzot madua be'eme lo nilham Hashem liyisrael ba'amalek kifi shilham Mitzrayim. And now come to think of it, really. Why did Bnei Israel have to fight? Why did Moshe Rabbeinu have to put his hands up? Why did Yehoshua have to go and choose men to go out and fight against the Amalekim? Why didn't God just clap his hands, snap his finger? All done. רבותינו שחשו בשאלה הזאת תלסו על המדרש. The Hachamim that sensed this question explained it in the Midrash. ויבוא עמלי וילחם עם ישראל ברפידים. אין רפידים אלא שרפו ידיהם מן התורה ולפיכך עמלי בעליהם. וכן אתה מוסר שאין השונא בא אלא על ידי רפיון ידיים מן התורה שנאמר ויהי כאחי מלכות רחבעם חזקתו עזה בתורת השם וכל ישראל עמו ומה עונשו עלה ששק מלך מצרים על ירושלים etc. So, מדרש תנחומה מפרשת בשלח זה החיים סדר, look at the pasuk that we're going to read. וַיָּבֹא עַמָּלֵי וַיִּלָּחֵם עִם יִשְׂרָאֵל בְּרְפִידִים. Okay, where is this Rephidim place? No, it's not where is Rephidim. The Hachaim said, what is Rephidim? Rephidim means that they removed themselves. They lifted their hands in removal from the Torah. And because they distanced themselves from Torah, therefore Amalek came upon them. And this is something that we find time and again, the Hachamim tell us, that the enemy, the hatred comes when? Any time we turn our backs on the Torah. If we ignore the Torah, bottom line is, what happens? Troubles come following us. And we saw it with Rehoboam. When he got the nation, when he left the Torah and he got the Am Yisrael to leave the Torah together with him, what was the punishment? Shishak, the king of Egypt, came and attacked Yerushalayim. Same thing. And we've seen it throughout history. We don't have to discuss it. Ve'achir. Hergishu kanir'ei Yisrael b'chat'am. And it seems that maybe Yisrael sensed their sin. עריב בני ישראל ואל נסותם את השם נמור היש אלוני בקרבנו עם עין. Is God among us? Did God leave us? Are we on our own? They weren't sure. וסמוך לו, and very close to it starts, ויבוא עמלק. עמלק came. לומר תמיד אני ביניכם זומן לכל צורכיכם ואתם אומרים היש אדוני בקרבנו. What are you talking about? I'm Hashem, I'm always here. I'm always among you. I'm always ready for all your needs. And you're asking, is God here among us? חייכם שהכלב בא ונושך אתכם ואתם צועקים אליי, תדעו היכן אני. Okay, let me show you. Let me send a dog to bite you. Okay? The dog bites, you're going to scream. Who are you going to scream to? You're going to scream to me. Hey, I'm sending my dogs. I'm sending Amalek. They're going to come. They're going to attack you. You're going to scream. And then you're going to see me again. Because I'm going to come out and help you. It's all about not forgetting Borei Olam. Not forgetting the Torah. We have to keep that in perspective. And it's so easy to forget that we all forget. We go about our business, we look around the world around us, and nobody else is doing anything. Why do we have to do anything? We have to. It's just part of our DNA. It's part of our makeup. It must go on. בכל הפרשה הזאת השתמשנו כמשל. Okay, we brought the stories now. We brought the different midrashim and the interpretations. But what are we here to learn? הנמשל ברור. מזה יובל שנים הולך ומתגלה לעם ישראל השגחת השם. Thanks. About 50 years that is becoming more and more apparent that God is really involved with Am Yisrael. He's talking about when he wrote this. This was published, keep in mind, this was published in 76. Okay? So figure from around
1926,
approximately. Things started changing. We all know history. We know what started happening with the League of Nations, Balfour Declaration. You know, things are going on. Things that nobody ever imagined. You know, UN partition plans, recognition of the state, the United States and Russia voting for it, declaring a Jewish state. What's going on? Things that nobody ever imagined would ever happen, happening like that, miraculously. You know, Six-Day War, 73 War. The Jews are just growing. And they're getting power. You know? Out of nowhere. God's there. Be'ayisim shibatenu el Yisrael. هي شربوتين وبا هي بسروتين وتحزقوتين على كرات المدينة. Jews started coming, started making aliyah, started settling, started strengthening in the land until the state was created. Shayeta kiruchah bin yisim rabim, all involved with great miracles. V'yisih et galut shechinat Hashem alayinu ba'a b'mahemet shishta yamim. And the climax, that pinnacle of the glory of God becoming apparent to us happened during the Six-Day War. And it was clear as day, like, you know, like lightning bolts, like sunshine coming upon us. This was the world. If you can open up, you know, history books till today, and go read what happened during the Six-Day War, the world didn't believe it. Nobody believed it was happening. And what happened? What did we do? Did we all go say, thank you, Hashem? Did we say, thank you, God? We want to bring the Torah into our lives? Did we say, we want to bring the Torah into our government? What did we do? V'ilu anu natashnu tabirit asher karat Hashem itanu. We tossed aside the berit, we tossed aside the Torah. I'll call them mashma'ut hanuba'at mikach. Ve'ulay mishum she'en anu yukhulim me'olam ladat il-nechon kabbalotayah shil hashgahal yonah ve'akol begedit hashara. Maybe because we can't really know. We don't know God's master plan. We don't know how he works, how he operates, what he wants from us, what his next move is. Maybe that's why we didn't do anything. Maybe we just sat back and said, okay, Hashem's calling the shots. Let's see what he's going to do next. And we'll sit back. Shizo sibbat ha-milhamot ha-rabbot va-kashot ha-pukdot otanu b'shalbeh ha-halatah di-gula. Maybe that's why all these wars are coming upon us. All these troubles are happening upon us at this time that we're, you know, the beginning of our redemption. La-hazkeinu et refidim shel dorenu. Kereh zakotenu li-gula shalena. To remind us about the Refidim, but those people who pull away from the Torah. That's the only way it's going to bring us to, we'll be able to merit a full redemption. What else do we need to learn from the war of Amalek? Okay. The miracles that were clearly done for Am Yisrael Misraim. It was all done, as we said, without the Jews living even a finger. And they all came to its final ending when the Jews were freed from Egypt. When it came to fighting Amalek, the Jews actually go out and fight physically. הקדוש ברוך הוא עזר להם במערכתם, אך לא נלחם במקומם. God, of course, helped them, but didn't fight in their place. זאת כבר רואים מרגע היציאה ממצרים. This we see immediately from the moment they left Egypt. ולא נלחם אלוהים דרך ארץ פלישתים. كي أمر الوهيم بين نحمها عام بين وتم الحماء بالشاب بمسرايمة. God said in the beginning of Parashat Beshalach. Okay? He didn't want to send them the simple road, the Derech Eretz Pelishtim. Okay, Hashem said, maybe they're going to see war and they're going to get afraid and they're going to want to turn back to Egypt. ומדוע לא ילחם הקדוש ברוך הוא בפלישתים בעצמו כפי שלחם במצרים? So why can't God fight the Pelishtim the same way he fought for Am Yisrael in Mitzrayim? אלא שלשאת במצרים, because to go out from Egypt, זאת עושה הקדוש ברוך הוא עצמו. בורא העולם did it himself. אך כיבוש הארץ צריכים לעשות ישראל בעצמם ובגופם. But conquering the land, Am Yisrael, the Jewish nation, has to do it themselves. With their own mind, with their own feeling, with their own emotion, with their own physical strength. Be'azrat Hashem ha'yusim sivotam. But with the help, and with the help of God, that is going along with them. Medina, e'er mekabbelim al magash zahab. A state, a country, it's not handed over to us on a gold platter. You got to work for it. You have to earn it.
It's a little different. It's a very different answer, second one.
Yeah. Umikan teshuba le'otam benedorenu. And here is the response to the people of our generation. Ha'hosheshim b'nei dimuta shel ha'geula ha'mashmeshet uba'a toh kedeh ha'kravat korbanot kol rabbim v'ikarim v'melhama she'ina poseket. People that are wondering, what's going on? This is the Geula, this is a redemption, it's coming to us through all these different wars where we're sacrificing our sons and daughters, our husbands, our fathers, people are just dying just like that. Shechen af Geula Yisrael Mitzrayim shehayeta b'galut Elohit b'mashit. Because even the Geula from Mitzrayim, which obviously was clearly done through the hands of God, and he was involved. Ne'elsu Yisrael lachem ve'af naflu mehem korbanot. Once they left the land of Egypt, the Jews had to participate, actively participate, on a regular basis. And many Jews fell in war. And we read it in the Chumash, we read it in the Nevi'im. It happened time and time again. It was bloody wars. Ha'chel b'reishit, Goyim Amalek, and it started with this head of all the Goyim Amalek. Shepatah nigdam milhama. They started the war. Ve'ad kibush ha'aretz midei Kena'an v'ad bichlal, until they came and entered the land and they had to fight with Kena'an and everybody else. Because she came bedurenu sheteru zechinu lehitgalot Elohim mushlemet me'az. And even now, when we're getting our land back, we still have to fight. We need to fight to get it. אך בוודאי טוב לנו כאשר נזכור את עמלק בדורו ובכל הדורות. But surely it'll be better for us when we remember עמלק in his generation, the generation of עמלק, and in all every generation. שבא בסיבת רפידים, that only comes time and again because of רפידים, because we lift our hands in removal from the Torah. רפיון ידיים מן התורה, נחביר חיילים בתורה. We also have to, the same way we have soldiers that we are training to go out to war, we also have to have soldiers in the Torah. And that will cause us to have a good, quick, and complete and speedy Geulah redemption. This so long ago. Yeah.
76.
Yeah. 35 years ago.
There wasn't so many people in Kol Elim either at the time.
No, there weren't tons of people in Kol Elim. The people were going out and fighting, etc. But nowadays we look at, oh, Torah Eretz Yisrael. Back then.
40 years ago.
40 years, yeah. No, 40, yeah.
39.
Almost. Yeah, almost 40. And it, this is when it was printed. So yeah, let's say it was written 40 years ago, maybe even 45 years ago. You know? It was a different time. It was a different world.
Yeah.
You know, they just got back Jerusalem. They were fighting to stay alive. You know, the amount of Jews that were living in Israel was very, very small. People weren't rushing to make Aliyah. People were barely visiting the country. They didn't know what was going to happen. All they saw was miracles all around them. All of a sudden, here we are, Jews with a country. But at the same time, every time we turn around, we're fighting a war.
Nothing changed today.
It changed for a little while.
Changed for a while. Now it's for...
But then we got too complacent.
Yes.
I think so.
We did. Yeah. The world's hatred is just resurfacing as well.
And how?
Beyond.
Yeah.